Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Savita Sharma from University of Delhi. Today we are going to discuss about the module Electro-Optic Modulators from paper Semiconductor Materials and Devices. From this module, students, you may get to know about the following. Firstly, the theory of electro-optic effect. Secondly, you will learn about the electro-optic effect in lithium niobate. Thirdly, we will study about the electro-optic modulators and also about the principle of their operation. Fourthly, we will study about the different methods to study the electro-optic effect. Before going into the detail, let us have a brief intro. Information processing is another field where optics plays a crucial role and has certain advantages with respect to electronic computing, such as massive parallelism, continuous data operation, direct data acquisition process. Implementation of fuzzy logic can be implemented, etc. External optic modulators are the key components of optical communication, which are extensively used in dense wavelength division multiplexing, that is the WDM systems. Numerous efforts has been made on the integration of lasers with modulators for efficient optical communication. Another advantage of optical modulators is their ability to make good use of the wide bandwidth of optical fibers. The Maxander is the most commercially used modulator because of low operating voltage and wide bandwidth, but has disadvantages of large insertion loss and high price. Various other types of modulators have been developed using the electro-absorption modulator, acoustic-optic modulator, electro-optic modulator, cavity-damping-based modulator, and photoelastic effect-based modulator. Electro-optic modulators are preferred because of fast response time and feasibility to realize in either reflection or transmission geometry. But much attention has been paid to electro-optic modulators with reflection geometry in the past few decades. Electro-optic modulators based on the electro-optic effect, which corresponds to the change in the refractive index of an anisotropic material with applied electric field, of being directionally dependent in a crystal. It can be defined as a difference in a material's physical or mechanical properties, that is, absorbance, refractive index, conductivity, etc., when measured along different axes. An example of anisotropy is the light coming through a polarizer. In an isotropic crystal, the refractive index is different in different crystal directions. The optically anisotropic crystals can be classified as uniaxial and optically biaxial crystals. Consider the coordinate system to be along the three principal axes, that is along x, y, and z directions of a crystal. Then we have the following relations. Epsilon x is equal to nx square, epsilon y is equal to ny square, epsilon z is equal to nz square. This is the first equation. Then the index ellipsoid equation describing the optical anisotropy of a crystal can be written as x square divided by nx square plus
y square divided by ny square plus z square divided by nz square is equal to 1. Let's call this equation as equation 2, where nx, ny and nz are the principal refractive indices along the respective axes as shown in figure 1. Figure 1 shows the refractive indices associated with the two plane waves propagating along the arbitrary directions k in a crystal. In the case of a biaxial system, there are two optical axes and the refractive indices are different in all three principal directions. That is, nx is not equal to ny is not equal to nz. The figure which you can see here is the optical indicatrix or index ellipsoid for a uniaxial crystal in which nx is equal to ny not equal to nz. The optic axis is parallel to the z axis. In an uniaxial crystal, we have nx is equal to ny is equal to n naught and nz is equal to ne, where n naught and ne are the ordinary and extraordinary refractive indices respectively. The refractive index along the optic axis corresponds to the extraordinary index, which is ne, and the refractive index perpendicular to the optic axis corresponds to the ordinary index n naught, which you can see in the given figure. The existence of two rays with different indices of refraction is called optical birefringence. The birefringence is usually defined as delta n equal to ne minus n naught. This equation, let's call it as equation number 3. Since the value of ne may be either higher or lower than n naught, birefringence may take positive or negative values. If delta n is greater than 0, the crystal is said to be positive, and if delta n is less than 0, it is said to be negative.
Let us discuss about permittivity tensor. The modulation of the properties of light propagating in an optically anisotropic crystal is the fundamental principle for the development of electro-optic device. But permittivity of the material can be characterized by its optical and dielectric properties and is an important parameter for the description of electro-optic effect, and therefore its origin is need to be explained and understood well. Polarization is an important phenomena while studying the electro-optic effect, where reallocation of both bound and free charges in response to an electric field within the material takes place. In an isotropic medium, the induced polarization P and the electric field E are related by a scale factor chi called susceptibility. The relation is given by P is equal to epsilon naught xi E, which we can call it as equation number 4, where epsilon naught stands for the permittivity of vacuum. In an anisotropic material, the induced polarization depends on the direction of the electric field vector, and it becomes necessary to define the susceptibility as a second rank tensor. Each of the polarization components, Pi, is dependent on the all three components of the electric field Et and can be written as or using Einstein notation as Pi is equal to epsilon naught xi ij ej, where I and j varies as 1, 2 and 3. we can name this equation as equation 5. The susceptibility tensor has clear physical origin and can be used to define the permittivity tensor epsilon ij as follows. Epsilon ij equals to pi equals to epsilon naught into xi ij into ej multiplied by 1 plus xi ij, which is the equation number 6.
The permittivity tensor relates the electric field vector E and the electric displacement vector D. So, dI is equal to epsilon ij multiplied by ej. Let's call this equation as equation 7. And so, it defines the dielectric properties of a crystal. If the medium is homogeneous, non-absorbing and magnetically isotropic, the permittivity tensor can be shown to be symmetric using the principle of the conservation of EM field energy. The same analysis applied to a non-absorbing optically active medium shows more general result. Epsilon ij is equal to epsilon ij star. Let's call this equation number 8, where epsilon ij is a complex conjugate of the permittivity epsilon ij star. The symmetrical property of the permittivity tensor makes it possible to find a coordinate system in which the tensor has only its diagonal elements. The axes of such coordinate system are called the principal dielectric coordinate axes and are of great importance for the description of the electro-optic effect. So, let's now discuss in detail the electro-optic effect. Electro-optic effect can be defined as the change in the refractive index due to ion displacement in a ferroelectric crystal with application of an external electric field. It is a nonlinear optic effect exhibited by ferroelectric materials when an electric field is applied, leading to the redistribution of charges in the crystal. Macroscopically, electro-optic effect can be described in terms of power series expansion of the polarization P, given as Pi is equal to Pi naught plus epsilon naught multiplied by xi ij 1 plus xi ijk 2 into ek plus xi ijk l 3 into ek into el plus so on multiplied by ej. Let's call this equation as equation 9, where xi 1 is the linear or the first order susceptibility and xi 2 and xi 3 are the second and third order nonlinear susceptibilities of the material. In the limit of low electric field, the above equation number 9 can be truncated linearly as Pi is equal to Pi naught plus epsilon naught into xi ij 1 into ej. So, let's call this equation as equation 10, which for an isotropic material gives n square is equal to epsilon is equal to epsilon naught into 1 plus xi 1, giving it the equation number 11. The above equation describes the linear optical properties of a material medium and the application of a static electric field to a second order nonlinear optical, that is the NLO material, is represented by the term in xi 2, as we can see in equation 9, where change in the refractive index of the material is proportional to the field referred to as linear electro-optic effect, which is also defined as the Pockels effect. Pockels effect describes a linear relationship between the induced change in birefringence delta N and the electric field E. Similarly, the term Xi 3 represents the quadratic variation of change in refractive index with applied field defined as Kerr effect. The linear electro-optic effect can be reflected as a change in rotation and deformation of the index ellipsoid, resulting in the variation in 1 by nx square, 1 by ny square, and 1 by nz square. Due to the rotation of the ellipsoid, cross terms have to be included. Due to the presence of an electric field, the equation for the index ellipsoid is given by b11 x square plus b22 into y square plus b33 into z square plus 2b3yz plus 2b31 into zx plus 2b12 into xy is equal to 1. Let's call this equation number 10, where the parameters bij are functions of the electric field E. In order to couple the six constants bij to three components of EI, 18 coefficients in the form of a 6×3 matrix are needed. So you can see the column matrix is equal to another 3×6 R matrix into a column E matrix. You can see the equation number 11 given in the form of one column matrix of B components equating to the 1×3 matrix of R into one column matrix of the different components of electric field. As evident from above equation, the electro-optic tensor, that is R, which is a 6×3 matrix having elements Rij, is represented as the electro-optic coefficients. The commonly exploited electro-optic material is lithium niobate, which belongs to the trigonal 3M point group having the following electro-optic tensor. R is equal to, which is a matrix of 3×6 having the different components of R and called as electro-optic tensor of lithium niobate. Let's call this equation number 12. It is often possible to avoid the complications of the cross terms by applying the external field parallel to one of the main orientations of the crystal and by choosing the corresponding polarization of the light. Applying the electric field along the C-axis of the lithium niobate crystal, that is E is equal to 00E, Nx and Ny are identical to N0, while Nz is equal to Ne propagates the extraordinary beam. So, by this logic, equations 11 and 12 that we saw above can reduce to the equation x square plus y square multiplied by 1 by N0 square plus R13 into E plus Z square multiplied by 1 by NE square plus R33 into E, and this complete equation is equals to 1.
Electro-optic modulators. Now let's study the principle of operation of electro-optic modulators. Integrated optical modulator is a device in which the light waves are confined to optical waveguides. The propagation of light waves is influenced by the change in the refractive index of the guided region with the applied electric field. So, sigma naught through the electro-optic effect of the medium. Electro-optic modulators are optical devices that can modulate a beam of light which can be used to transmit information. Because of the high frequencies of the optical waves, very high modulation bandwidths are possible with light as a carrier of information. The optical beam may be modulated in phase, frequency, polarization, amplitude, and direction. The phase and amplitude modulators are attractive due to simple design. In case of long distance optical transmission, a waveform is susceptible to degradation due to nonlinear effect such as self phase modulation and so on. A phase modulator can be used to alter the phase of the carrier to compensate for the degradation. A phase modulator is a device that manipulates the phase of optical carrier signals under the influence of applied electric field. When the voltage is not applied, a number of periods of light waves, that is n, exist in a certain path length. When voltage is applied to the RF electrode, one or a fraction of one period of a wave is added, which now implies n plus 1 waves exist in the same length. In this case, the phase has been changed by 2 pi, and in this condition, the half voltage is called the driving voltage.
Phase modulators involve variation of the phase of the carrier wave. The change in refractive index, that is delta n, of a biased electro-optic material will depend on effective electro-optic coefficient, RC, which is dependent on the orientation of the material and light polarization, and the magnitude of the applied field, VT, as delta n equals to 1 by 2 n cube into R into VT divided by D. Let's call this equation as equation 14. Here D is the thickness of the electro-optic material. The phase of the wave after passing through the length of material L will change with applied voltage VT as delta phi equals to K into V into L minus K into naught into L, which gives 2 pi by lambda into delta N into L, or we can write it as minus pi n cube into R into VT into L divided by lambda into D. Let's call this equation as equation 15. In the case of a simple sinusoidal modulation of the applied voltage, that is equals to Vm sine omega mt, the optical output wave can be written as Et equals to A cos omega t minus delta phi equals to A cos omega t plus pi into n cube into R into L into Vm into sine omega mt divided by lambda into D, which in turn can be written as A into cos omega t plus phi m sine omega mt. This is the equation 16. The output field of phase modulated with the modulation index is written as phi m equal to pi into n cube into R into Vm into L divided by lambda into D. Let's call this equation as equation 17. Amplitude or intensity modulation can be achieved, for example, by putting a phase modulator in one branch of the interferometer, most commonly a Mach-Zehnder interferometer, where a beam splitter is used to divide the laser light into two beams, one of which passes through the phase electro-optic modulator. The two beams are again combined with another beam splitter. If the incoming beam has an amplitude A and the beam splitters are dividing a wave into two equal parts, the outgoing field is the sum of two interfering beams. So E out is equals to E1t plus E2t, which is written as 1 by 2 a cos omega t plus 1 by 2 a cos omega t minus delta phi, which can be again written as a into cos delta phi by 2 into cos omega t minus delta phi by 2. Let's name this equation as equation 18. The outgoing signal beam intensity is proportional to e square t averaged in time. So I out is equal to I in into cos square delta phi by 2, which can be written as I in cos square pi n cube r l v divided by lambda d into 2, which is equal to I in into cos square pi v divided by 2 v pi. This is the equation number 19, where I in is the input beam intensity. The half wave voltage v pi can be defined as v pi is equal to lambda into d divided by n cube into r into l. This is the equation number 20. The resulting transmittance of the interferometer t is equal to I out divided by I in is a function of Vt. The half wave voltage V pi is the applied voltage needed to change the transmittance from 0 to 1, that is to operate the device in a limited region around Tv is equal to 0.5. This can be adjusted by changing the length of one arm of the interferometer, and a linear intensity modulator is obtained. The modulated transmitted light intensity is directly proportional to the applied electric signal Vt, as t is almost equal to or approximately equal to 1 by 2 into 1 plus pi into Vt divided by V pi. This is the equation number 21. The half wave voltage V pi, which is we saw in equation number 18, is an important parameter for device applications. It is minimized for each device geometry and carrier wavelength by large n cube r, which is the figure of merit for electro-optic material. On the other hand, V pi can be reduced by optimizing the geometry, that is long propagation distance L and short electrode distance D greatly reduce V pi. Various method to study electro-optic effect. There are several established methods to measure the electro-optic coefficients of crystals, which include Mach-Zehnder interferometry, Senar mount method, ATR method, and measurement of transmittance change. Mach-Zehnder interferometry is used to observe the interference between split light beams, where an electric field is applied to one of the beam paths. However, it is troublesome to fabricate waveguides through patterning and etching when applying this technique to thin films. The Senarman mount method is based on measuring electric field induced phase retardation, that is the birefringence. Enhanced sensitivity can be achieved by modulating incident light with lock-in detection. The substrate must be transparent and measurement is done only for alternate changing electric fields. As the ATR method employs a prism coupling configuration, the sample is slightly damaged when the prism is clamped. Another shortcoming common to the above techniques is that the electro-optic coefficient is obtained at a single wavelength of laser light. Senar mount compensator method, which is a birefringence based method, can measure a small difference between the ordinary and extraordinary refractive indices rather than measuring the change of individual refractive index. The birefringence in a crystal can be detected by placing the sample between a pair of crossed polarizers to convert the birefringence induced light polarization change to the output light intensity change. Therefore, any birefringence change caused by modulating the refractive index can be measured by recording the output intensity.
So, students, let us summarize what we have learned in this module. First of all, we learned about the theory of electro-optic effect, and electro-optic effect in lithium niobate, we have discussed it in detail. Then we studied about the electro-optic modulators, and their principle of operation was discussed. Then we discussed in brief the different methods that we can use to study the electro-optic effect. Thank you.